Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether any changes to the current devolution settlement should only be implemented with the explicit democratic consent of the Scottish people.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish devolution settlement is founded on the principle that the people of Scotland are governed only with their consent. The devolution settlement built in a requirement that changes to this Parliament's powers should only be made with the agreement of this Parliament, either by approval of Section 30 orders or by legislative consent under the Sewell Convention. Unfortunately, the current UK government has failed to adhere to the democratic principle and has restricted the powers of this Parliament without its agreement.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. Labour leader Keir Starmer says that winning the next UK general election delivers a mandate for his party to implement constitutional change, but refuses to recognise that a pro-independence victory across Scotland would also deliver a similar mandate. What does that say about Labour's credentials as a democratic party, and does he have any confidence that their timid and compliant branch office in Scotland might evolve a different view, one that respects the democratically expressed wishes of the Scottish people?
Cabinet Secretary.
This double standard undermines the credibility of Labour's recent constitutional report. It would be unacceptable for changes to devolution to be made without the agreement of the Scottish Parliament. Proceeding to implement proposals to change the devolution settlement on the basis of a manifesto pledge while denying the right of a Scottish government elected to hold a referendum on independence on the same basis would further undermine Scottish democracy. I would note in passing, Presiding Officer, that the House of Commons debated measures yesterday which could have ensured that this Parliament would have the power to hold a referendum on Scotland's future. The Tories voted to block Scottish democracy and the Labour Party abstained.
Willie Rennie.
I have repeatedly asked questions in this Parliament over recent weeks on currency, on Europe, on border checks for an independent Scotland, but ministers have been unable to answer any of them. Is the Cabinet Secretary sure he's ready for a referendum?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would be delighted to have a referendum and I would be delighted to have the support of the Scottish Liberal Democrats that we could hold a referendum in Scotland. Perhaps Willie Rennie could confirm how Liberal Democrat MPs voted in yesterday's vote in the House of Commons. I suspect they bravely abstained.
Question number two has been withdrawn. Question number three, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the National Treatment Centre Highland will be fully operational.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
NTC Highland is on track to open in April 2023.
Edward Mountain.
I'm sorry, Presiding Officer, I couldn't hear that answer.
Cabinet Secretary, if you could repeat, please.
NTC Highland is due to open in April 2023.
Edward Mountain.
And I thank the Minister for that answer, and I too welcome the long overdue National Treatment Centre in Inverness and the fact that it's nearing completion, only 18 months late. Patients need this facility now more than ever, especially as research shows that there is a risk of a 7-year wait for orthopaedic treatment. Unacceptable waiting times will not begin to be reduced until the National Treatment Centre has a full workload and in place, and they aren't, 30% still to be recruited. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that it will not only open on the 3rd of April, but will be fully operational on the 3rd of April?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm going to say to Edward Mountain, I know it is the season, but he shouldn't be such a grinch when it comes to this fantastic investment that the SNP-led Scottish Government is making in Inverness and in Highland. He should welcome the fact that we're on track to deliver 1,350 orthopaedic procedures in the first year of NTC Highland opening up. He should be grateful, of course, for the investment that the SNP government is making in Highland. It's the right thing to do. It was the right thing to do. In fact, our NTC programme, of course, was one that we announced pre-pandemic. But even more important given the pressures of the pandemic. Of course, staffing and recruitment is ongoing. He mentioned some of the figures of workforce by NHS Highland. Those recruitment efforts are ongoing. And of course, as he would expect in a project of this size and this scale, there will be a phased... it will open, of course, rightly so, in a phased manner. But it will meet that target that I set out in October of 1,350 orthopaedic procedures in the first financial year.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Maybe panto season, but I'm not sure the audience bought that answer. 1 in 7 Scots are currently languishing on waiting lists. It was reported earlier this year that half the government's NTCs would be delayed. So it's not just an issue in Highland. So will the Cabinet Secretary tell us that... does he accept that jam tomorrow is not good enough? And is he going to tell us whether he expects there to be any further slippage elsewhere in the country in the current timetable?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, I gave a recent update in relation to national treatment centres and what their opening dates are. I'm happy to write to Paul O'Kane if he hadn't seen that update and provide the latest in that regard. But this government is, of course, taking steps to deal with those long waits. What, of course, was missing from the pantomime villain's answer, Paul O'Kane's answer, his question was the fact that the pandemic has had a huge impact, of course, and he is just burying his head in the sand, Presiding Officer, if he does not recognise the impact and the effect that the biggest shock our NHS has ever faced in its 74-year existence has had. We have seen some progress in reducing the longest waits right up and down the country, and that is the relentless focus of my role, but also of this government as a whole.
Question number 4, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has recently had with the Scottish Resilience Partnership in preparation for winter.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
The Scottish Resilience Partnership is a strategic policy forum for resilience issues which takes a common approach to setting strategic direction and priorities for resilience in Scotland. I can confirm that the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans attended the most recent SRP meeting on the 25th of October and discussed with partners their updates on the preparations that they were taking for winter. This included learning from previous severe weather events and testing and exercising. SRP Chair Jim Savage was present at the SCORE-M meeting on the Wednesday the 2nd of November and provided a brief update. SRP Deputy DCC Graham was present on Tuesday the 8th of December to represent SRP.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Throughout this week, Scotland has seen a significant drop in temperatures with associated yellow weather warnings issued. Industrial action south of the border has moved travellers onto roads, Shetland householders have been without power, and tragically, the risks around frozen ice on lakes were highlighted earlier in the week. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to outline what steps our constituents should take this winter to ensure they stay safe during adverse weather events and where they can find the best available information and advice?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the best location for constituents to seek advice on what they should do in during periods of adverse weather is through the Scottish Government Ready Scotland website, ready.scot. It provides information for the public on how to prepare and stay safe during periods of severe winter weather, including warning people not to venture onto frozen water. The advice also includes keeping up to date with the latest weather warnings, checking on vulnerable neighbours, and also in the event of a power failure to call 105 free of charge for help and advice. I certainly want to encourage anyone who is seeking advice to make access of this particular resource, which provides a whole range of different information on what action could be taken during adverse weather.
Question number 5, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government to provide an update on the Promise Scotland.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The Promise Scotland set-up plan 21-24 sets the outcomes that must be achieved by organisations across Scotland by 2024. They are specifically engaged in key national work on the children's hearing system redesign, development of a model for lifelong advocacy, and involvement in work to understand the best models of governance and financial arrangements of care. At local level, they are working with children's services partnerships and national bodies with their own delivering plan 21-24, bringing together and supporting common interests and activities.
Rona Mackay.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Could the Minister please give an outline of financial and family support currently available to adopted children in Scotland?
Minister.
There are a range of financial practice support available to adopted children, young people and their families. All local authorities have a legal duty to provide support to meet the needs of adoptive families, which could include an adoption allowance in certain circumstances. We are also taking direct action this year. We've initiated the whole family wellbeing programme activity to help transform the delivery of holistic family support. This includes investing £32 million through children's services planning partnerships and supporting them in driving this work at the local level. We've also provided £350,000 to third sector organisations to support adopted children, young people and families. That's included things like funding Adoption UK Scotland to provide a national helpline and funding Birthlink to provide and maintain an adoption contact register to support contact between adopted people and their birth parents and relatives.
Thank you. Question number six, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the progress of the Barra and Battersea Community Campus project.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
We are pleased to see that there has been extended engagement with the community and service delivery partners on a range of approaches, and the preferred cluster approach will ensure that a community hub is created. NHS Western Isles has submitted their outline business case for the replacement of St Brendan's Hospital to the Scottish Government, and the business case will be reviewed and assessed by the NHS Capital Investment Group at their next meeting in January. Following that review, we will make a decision on next steps based on the recommendation from that group. Scottish Government officials and the Scottish Futures Trust remain in close contact with the Council and NHS Western Isles regarding delivery of this vital project, which will serve the Barra community.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer and welcome the progress on this much-needed facility. I wonder if I can ask if she is able to confirm when the next stages in the process of approving finance will be and when more detailed architect's drawings might be available for the community to see.
Cabinet Secretary.
In relation to the health elements of the campus, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care will decide on the next steps and approval of finance after the business case has been reviewed by the NHS Capital Investment Group in the new year. The funding for the school elements of the campus has already been approved through phase one of the Learning Estate Investment Programme, with further detailed discussions ongoing as the project develops. The design proposals were shared publicly earlier this year as part of the planning process. The feedback was very positive and allowed the process to continue with expected wide community support. And following approval to proceed into the next stage of development in the new year, the design information will be available to the community for comment through the planning process.
Question number seven, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it ensures that NHS boards comply with public procurement rules in relation to the purchase and operation of specialist medical equipment.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
Specialist medical equipment is purchased from regulated procurement frameworks where available, or under no procurement, under new procurement tenders initiated in accordance with the relevant legislation. Health boards employ specialist procurement professionals to ensure compliance with procurement rules. NHS standing financial instructions stipulate the required governance concerning the procurement of all products and indeed services. The Scottish Government provides procurement guidance and support to all health boards via its procurement website, procurement policy notes and indeed the Scottish Procurement Policy Handbook.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response? My constituent, Jason Donnelly of Medical Devices UK, has raised very serious concerns with me about failures in procurement practice, breaches of FOI legislation and potentially unsafe working practices within NHS Grampian. He has also, I believe, raised these concerns with his constituency MSP, John Swinney. Mr Swinney wrote to the Health Secretary raising these concerns on the 8th of March this year, but to my knowledge there has not been a response to that letter. I myself wrote to the Health Secretary on the 13th of June and again on the 30th of September, but have not had a response. Given the very serious matters that my constituent has raised, when will I receive a reply to my letters, and will the Health Secretary institute an urgent inquiry into the concerns that have been raised that affect patient safety?
Cabinet Secretary.
I will, of course, look into any reasons why Mr Fraser has not received a response, and of course I apologise if that has been unnecessarily delayed. The issues that have been raised by his constituent, and he's correct, also been raised to me via the Deputy First Minister, are making pretty serious allegations and quite a long and a complex procurement issue. Therefore, I can confirm to Murdo Fraser, I have asked Greater Glasgow and Clyde to provide an external review in relation to the allegations and concerns that have been raised. I've asked Greater Glasgow and Clyde to report back to me by the end of January, and I'll keep Murdo Fraser and indeed the constituency MSP, John Swinney, updated on the outcome of that external review.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree, accept that the Scottish Government can learn from the potentially fraudulent mistakes of the UK Government and rule out the use of VIP procurement lanes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, absolutely. VIP lanes, of course, were a measure that were introduced by the UK Government during the pandemic to procure PPE. They were used by government officials, ministers, MPs, members of the House of Lords, and health professionals to submit offers of PPE. That is perhaps itself problematic, but there are further concerns that, of course, proper due diligence, to put it mildly, was not carried out in some of those VIP lane submissions. Now, we're used to job for the boys. When it comes to the Conservatives, perhaps it's jobs for the baronesses too.
Jackie Bailey.
FOIs have shown that previous SNP health secretaries were aware of this wrongdoing by NHS Grampian in relation to Mr Donnelly. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain why the government has taken so long to take action in this very serious case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'd be careful if Ms Bailey has concrete evidence that there was wrongdoing. She's happy to provide that to me and indeed provide that to Greater Glasgow and Clyde, who are going to be conducting the external review. So I think it's important that we allow Greater Glasgow and Clyde to conduct that external review. And as I've said, I've asked for that external review to be completed by the end of January next year, and I can keep Ms Bailey updated on its outcome.
Question number 8, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what the next steps are in implementing buffer zones outside abortion clinics in Scotland in light of the UK Supreme Court judgment on this issue handed down on 7 December 2022.
Minister Marie Todd.
The Scottish Government welcomes the UK Supreme Court's judgment. We are carefully considering the judgment in the Scottish context and remain committed to supporting Gillian Mackay, MSP, with the development of her Members Bill to safeguard access for women in Scotland to healthcare facilities that provide abortion services without fear, harassment or intimidation.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Minister for her response. It's vital that healthcare services can be accessed without harassment, and going forward, I hope we can continue the commitment to work cross-party on this issue. Now that the UK Supreme Court has clarified the legal situation on buffer zones, can I ask, Minister, when the Scottish Government expect to convene the next abortion summit?
Minister.
We remain committed to working with other parties across the chamber to ensure that women can access fundamental health services without feeling harassed or intimidated, as is their right. Officials are exploring potential dates for the Summit on Abortion Care, which is currently expected to take place in February 2023.
Thank you. That concludes general questions. There'll be a very short pause before we move to First Minister's questions.